They had paid snitches, they had paid agent provocateurs in the organization. All of that was a part of what was happening to disorient and disunify the movement, which left a void. And when that void was there, then they were beginning to move in a lot of destructive behavior. There was no games in Watts in the 60s, not one. Not one game until after the thing began to be destroyed. The Panther Party, the Sons of Watts, and then the void began to be filled with youngsters with no direction, no purpose, no identity. But there was, even in that, there was some, like even, well, you know, Tupac's mother was a Panther, right. You know, so it was people who still had that level of consciousness, but they had not came on the scene. And then some of it was by design and some of it was by default, because the language and the direction that the words were used in terms of gangster rap and vulgar rap was to undermine the respect and the relationship that black men and black women had built up over the 60s, because it was like sister this and sister that. It was a level of respect and appreciation for the black woman and the contribution and her role in the movement, and they took them from there to itches and witches and everything else, and just took them down to body parts, strictly body parts, not a brain even in the vicinity, let's only in their head. And I think all of that was a part of the bigger movement that we were not prepared for, because we felt, because we was on the right side of history, it was enough. But you not only have to develop what you deal with, what the future has for, but you've got to be able to defend it. You've got to be able to do it. If you cannot defend what you develop, someone will take it from you and take you with it.
This question kind of like echoes the question a little bit, but like, if you have such like a strong unification of the people in the 19, like during that movement, like how does it come that they get to where they are now, where they don't have the sense of like they were so, like, the way you talk about it, they're so strong and united, like how do they get to the point where they don't even know, where we don't even know where our culture now?
Okay. We were not perfect. We were not perfect. Anything can be destroyed. Anything can be destroyed. And it was, especially if there's evil or somebody who wanted to destroy you. Every soul has a price tag. Every soul has a price tag. Including America, if you know history, you know about Benedict Arnold, who sold his soul out to the rich for whatever reason. There were black people that during this time who got bought out by the almighty dollar. Another thing, the dollar is God in this society. Enough money will make you kill your mama, if it's enough. I don't care how much you love her. You might say, well, I'm gonna kill your mama, but I'm gonna bring you roses to your funeral every day. Enough money. The love of money and material in this country is the number one thing that is used as a tool to undermine and destroy a people and a movement. If it's enough money, your even friends in this room here, if they get in an argument, it'll usually be over one or two things. Your man, your woman, or your money. That'll break you up. I don't care what it is. And the same thing with your family. Your mothers and your father, if you taking everything out of the house, that's why they tell you, get a job. Because you're an economic burden by just laying up there doing nothing. So part of it was like, we all human beings, we're not saints now. We all had our faults. There's no perfect people that ever existed in the world. From what I understand, not even in heaven. That's why the devil got busted. That's from what I understand. I don't know. I wasn't there. But to disunify people is not a monumental task. It's just a question of dedication and commitment to destroy and undermine. And so, yeah, we had gaps in the movement, but it didn't make us any less strong. If your grandmother didn't get no more than a third grade education, she was no less committed to you and no less than your grandmother because she didn't have a college education. So we had gaps then and we have gaps now. You will not be a perfect person, and the leadership or the young people in this room will not be perfect. Some people in here will get a job someplace and will be charged with undermining other things that happen. It was black police officers. It was black police officer that was Malcolm X's bodyguard. Mm-hmm. Black police officer. It was a Brothers in the Panther Party who got paid off by the Panther Party. Just because I'm talking of dedicated, that's why I say leadership is by it's a lonely road, because you can be gotten to quote a line from The Godfather. If history has taught us one thing, that is no man who cannot be gotten to. No man. And back to, they crucified Jesus, and he was the Son of God. I mean, people say that's what he came for to do, but nobody can be gotten to. So we're not talking here perfection and it's never going to happen if we had absolute anything. The only thing that I know that is absolute in life is death. I don't know of anything else. I'm open to learn this. Anyone else?
I have a question. As we're in a time where we don't necessarily have the leaders that they had in the 60s, MLK, Martin Luther King, would you say that the Nation of Islam would be something beneficial if more black people were to join to bring back that passion and strength that they had in the 60s?
I think any group of black people with a right agenda, an agenda of righteousness, and you know, and well-being and self-development is a good organization. Mm-hmm. Not just one organization. You don't want to be in any one of anything, because different people have different beliefs, just different stuff. It wouldn't hurt, but I do believe that everybody should belong to an organization, a group, or something that's doing something positive and good in the world and doing something to enhance your development. Whatever the Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, and church. You know, plenty of churches around, but you just want to get into something good. So I believe that everybody should be a member of something that's doing something positive in the community and building character and strength and commitment in human beings.
Okay, let me bring this full circle to a close with a couple of things as we wrap up. I'm very pleased to say that even though we are in the middle, and I know you had to have seen the most recent news announcements about cutbacks, and what I gave you the other day, it's really become very serious class, because they had already cut back 10,000 students. You need to know that this 10,000 they talk about now is an additional 10,000, and where they're moving on it, it begins with those applying. For admission now have just 2 weeks up till November 30th if they haven't applied, forget about it. Just a lot of things happening. That could be a subject in and of itself. I mean, there are things going on. Having said that, with this cutback freeze, all that, I'm still pleased to be able to say that our department chair, Dr. Spencer Walters, the department were able to provide Tommy Duquette here, but he wasn't even talking about it, but with the, at least a small honorarium, you know, as a token of appreciation, and coming. But then something I'd like to do, you know, it's always good to recognize these kind of dedications, and I mean, like I said, I call this a lifetime friend, and like I said, when we write one another, I always send my letters to him, yours in struggle. That's what it's about. But again, a book first. This is one of our people. Oh, come on up, Tommy. This is Michael Eric Dyson, his book, Debating Race. I'm going to put a little something in, but I want to first present, you know, this to you. And then somebody saw in my office, but I said, let me go on and give him this right here. This is a keepsake because he likes things that are cultural. And I think all of you have met with me, so I really want to take the...
Oh, man. What was that?
Sunday Best, Southside Chicago, 1941. And when you look at it, can't you say that really is a story? You know, like a young black American. What I'm going to do, in this instance, I'm going to hold it for just a moment because I want to give, over the next week or so, give all the students in the class an opportunity to sign it for you, please. You know, so that, you know, we can do that and send it to them. In fact, I'll leave that to the class to coordinate, but where everybody has a chance to sign it on the back to him.
This is Brenda Giles. She's my executive assistant, and see, she's a female. But I could have not done any of the stuff that I've done without her and other females that were behind me and supported me 100% in all the things that I've done, including my family. It is absolutely necessary that we as a people understand, you know, how we complement one another, and our role as a people is to complement. Women make us whole, and we make women whole. So it's important that we treat our sisters and our women with the utmost respect. It is the one thing, if we do nothing else in this life, we get back to that again. And I want to present Johnny with, this is one of our t-shirts from this year's festival. And our theme is Watts, Our Place in History. And this is a copy of Watts Stack's Coliseum concert that we did in 1972. We were the first black concert ever held in the history of the Coliseum. It was built in 1932. We were the first one ever had a concert there. It was a sellout concert of over 100,000 people, and it was like no problem. Not one single arrest took place. Not one major incident in the whole history at the Coliseum.
Thank you. Thank you.